Welcome to the worship of First Baptist Church of Los Angeles. Today is the 13th of December, 2020. Come, let us worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Let's pray together. Thank you, God, for the blessing of your presence, that your Son Jesus has come to be with us, and he shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. Thank you, God, that you have come to dwell in our midst, that you have sent your own beloved begotten Son into the world to forgive us, to give us new life, born of your Holy Spirit, by grace and truth that you impart within us as we open our hearts to believe, and as we receive that work of your grace and salvation, the new life born of your Spirit. In this day we celebrate the coming of Jesus. Amen. As we come to this third Sunday of Advent, we light the third candle of Advent. We have lit the candles of hope, the candles of joy, and also now today the candle of peace. We find that God has come to us through Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life. We have hope in Jesus. And so God lights the hope of his kingdom within us. And we find in Jesus we have joy, the joy that comes from God's Holy Spirit, the joy that comes trusting in God and his love, trusting in him. And today we celebrate the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, who lights our hearts, enlightens our minds with God's peace and the way of peace. The shalom of God comes to us and works in us through Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. May his government, may his love for us, may his saving work within us be increased. May the zeal of the Lord God Almighty accomplish his will in us. Amen.
Thank you. bring your light o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King.
Soul fell break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is our Lord, forever ever praise we.
Welcome. Glad you could join us. This is Scott Arnold, pastor of First Baptist Church of Los Angeles, and with me is Dean Batten. Together, we are going to explore the meaning of Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, and primarily the phrase that we find from the Old Testament prophet about Prince of Peace, how Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and understanding that in our time, certainly understanding in its original context, and in light of the incarnation of God in Jesus Christ, his Son, and what that means as far as the kingdom of God within us, and how we are to live with that peace that helps us overcome sin, the impasses of this life, the trials and troubles that we face, and finding that there is a reality of peace that abides in our hearts and can transform our minds and who we are as God's children. So just as a little introduction, Dean, why don't you say a word or two about yourself and maybe a little bit about your journey that's led you to be able to share today.
I'm Dean Batten. I'm originally from Florida. My mother was raised in the Southern Baptist Convention. Her father was a music minister. She in turn picked up music ministry as her career, and that's been her life's work. So I was raised around that, and my father, when I was around 9 years old or so, he converted to Roman Catholicism. So I had a fairly wide variety of Christianities introduced to me as a child. My uncle on my dad's side is a Buddhist, and his son is a fairly he's not a monk, but he's a very serious Zen practitioner. And I have Wiccans on that side of my family, and my mother's whole side is, they're all Baptist, more or less. My mother is working with a really wonderful Presbyterian church in my hometown. And so through these varieties of Christianity, I somehow hit adolescence and became a very angry young man. I threw it all away and went seeking something else. And through studying everything from hard materialist, philosophical, atheist stuff, all the way to Buddhism and Vedanta, the Hindu practices and teachings, I eventually, I've found my way back to Christ, because something I continued to run into was, whether I was reading Buddhist literature, whether I was reading Hindu literature, it was always being translated into English, and the language that they used was fundamentally Christian. The words that they would use to describe various Hindu holy men would be saint. And they would describe bodhisattvas from Buddhism the same way. It would always be translated as saint. And it was like, okay, well, I have all this Christian language. Maybe I should look at this again. And through a lot of meditation, the introduction of a prayer practice, and then I bought a copy of the, I want to say it's either the New International Version or the New Revised Standard, and I began reading. And then I began healing my relationship with both of my parents, because I started to talk to them about Christianity and to explore this. And the hunger that I had as an angry teenager took me to, it created this sort of like fever, like I really needed something. And so I had to go all the way back around to figure out that what the stories were that I was being told as a kid, and the tradition that I initially rejected so flippantly was in fact what spoke to me the most. And so the approach that I have to the Bible, to Christianity, is I think informed by a lot of these experiences. I think it would be, in a manner, it would be in bad faith if I tried to reject them categorically. You know truth when you see it, and the Holy Spirit will always work with what it has on hand. And so, looking back now, I mean, I'm only 24, but looking back on this last, call it a decade, the thing I see most working is Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit working to bring me to some kind of serious love and a sort of middling understanding. So that's what I'm coming to all of this with, is this sort of this attempt to understand what is around me, and the tool that has proven itself to be the most useful is God. God is where understanding comes from. It's the fountain of, well, everything. It's where everything comes from.
You have a serious love for God and serious love for Jesus, and comes because you've received that grace that he's given you, and big time. And it's been a pleasure to see God working in your life. And just to get started, I'll read this whole passage, Isaiah 9, 6 to 7. In Isaiah 9, verses 6 to 7, we hear this, the New International Version. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Can you imagine being Isaiah and receiving this message? And Isaiah lived at a time when kings felt that they had indisputable authority. And at times, kings, in their warring defense at times, and other times in their warring offense, would justify things, sometimes for the good of the people and sometimes for the good of themselves and their ego. Now, I hear that passage, and I think about the peace that can prevail over the impasses of life. And what are impasses? And I think of that there is an impasse of our human nature, that at the core, there's a distortion, a corruption, and that can at times become an impasse. We can only go so far in our walk of life and our journey of life until we realize that we on our own have failings. We have an internal war within. And until we have that peace with God, we really are at an impasse. And even when we do have peace with God, we still need God's help to deal with our own sin and the impasse of sin. You know, one of the ways that we say the Lord's Prayer is, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." That its root talks about impasses, things that get in the way of relationships, get in the way of things being what they should be. And so, as I hear Isaiah speak in verse 6, he's talking about a peace that is personally born in Jesus Christ. He's talking about a peace that one can know through the Prince of Peace. And so the first thing we hear is that peace is personally born in Jesus Christ. For to us a child is born, and to us a son is given. God has desired to come to us, and that the government of God's kingdom is not on our shoulders. And so many times leaders try to say, "It's on my shoulders." Mm-hmm. Like they try to shoulder the kingdom of God.
They try to adopt the role.
Yeah, let's talk about that for a minute. I know our plan was a little different, but this whole thing about people trying to take the government of God upon their shoulders, where do we see this happening?
You see it anywhere you look. everywhere from interpersonal relationships, groups of people, friends, coworkers, to certain countries, representative democracies in the Western world, I won't name any names, but where people, anytime I think people try to assume or adopt a position of power and authority, they end up abusing it. And that's because, well, they are only human. And that is the, in a way, that's sort of original sin showing its face again. It's the thing we always do. It's why we needed Jesus, because we're always, we assume far too much of ourselves, that we're capable of wielding power without it ruining us, without it corrupting us. And it's because there's always this issue of maybe selfishness, or maybe the fact that if you're in a position of power, it would be very, very easy to just do what you want and screw the consequences. And that's the thing that I think we see a lot, which is why this whole notion, to me, of the Prince of Peace is such a unique concept. It's why it's so powerful to me, this Prince of Peace notion, because what he is saying is that God, what Isaiah, I think, is saying here with just those three words, Prince of Peace, he is saying that God incarnates himself as a human, comes down here and says, "Okay, you guys keep messing it up and you keep doing it wrong. You need something here. You guys obviously crave a hierarchy. You need to follow somebody. But none of you is capable of doing it. You keep buggering the situation. So what we can do is I'll come down. I'll make myself a man so that you can follow me." And instead of coming into a position of power and then using it to gratify myself, or using it to abuse others and exert power to, you know, facilitate my toxic masculine ego or whatever else, instead of doing that, I'm going to bring you the exact opposite. And because I'm God, even though I'm here in a human body that is temporary, like, I'm still God, and with me is going to come eternal peace. And the only thing you really have to do is understand that I am what authority is. I am where it comes from, and I'm the only now person who is allowed or even really capable of wielding it. Which is why this notion of the Prince of Peace is so important and so unbelievably powerful.
Yeah.
It gives us somebody to submit to who is actually capable of doing it without abusing us. It's the only one I can think of.
Yeah, and historically, you think of so many different leaders, kings, who be they military, political, religious, social, who will at first may seem to be someone to follow, someone whose ideas or perspective you agree with and you'd like to follow that leader. But in time, you know, power can certainly corrupt almost anybody,
yeah.
Anybody. And the wonderful thing that we have in this promise that is given is that God will give the one to govern, and his own son would come in the fullness of time,
yeah.
As a promise. God gave this to the people of Israel, and in the fullness of time, Jesus came. But we do see, like you say, so many people who will either ride the coattails of a corrupt leader, maybe not corrupt at first, but maybe the power corrupted them. Well, corrupt in potential and then in actuality.
Yeah.
But yes, I mean, the whole understanding of Prince of Peace is really turning it upside down from the world point of view to
yeah.
God's point of view of what can and will bring true peace.
Yeah, it inverts the human history of what princeness is.
Yeah.
And says, well, here's something that you poor creatures will be able to understand that actually may help you. And that's the
yeah.
that's the notion of what Christ is. It's God with us, Emmanuel. And yeah.
Yeah, and the other thing in verse 6 it goes on. It says, and Isaiah says, from what God is giving him, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and there we have the Prince of Peace. And the connection of all these, they are all intertwined. And I know in some cases scholars have said that we sometimes put these together, Wonderful Counselor. But you could also, from looking at the original text, say Wonderful. There's like a Hebrew character,
yeah.
Counselor, Mighty God, and
yeah.
So you, while you connect these, you can also, looking at the original text in Hebrew, you could actually even say that they are individual characteristics. Everlasting, Father, and then Prince of Peace, you know. So what I hear is that God gave his son to counsel and strengthen us with peace.
You can't see it, but underneath my mask, my jaw was open. Wow, that's actually an absolutely fascinating detail. I'm not familiar with the original Hebrew, so I sort of lean on translations with my fingers
right,
crossed.
Right. Yeah.
That actually makes a lot of sense.
Right.
Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God.
Right.
Like not you know, two word conjunctions, but
right.
like actually individual concepts on their own,
uh-huh.
all of which perfectly pertain to this notion of,
oh, yeah.
of the Messiah.
Oh yeah.
That's far out, man.
Yeah, I think my Old Testament professor Radar Bjornard from Northern Seminary in Chicago for that detail.
It's a useful one.
It is. It really is. Well, then looking at verse 7 here, there are three things that I see in verse 7, and we can talk about this, but the overall concept that we hear in verse 7 is that peace shall prevail by the will of the Almighty, our gracious God, and through his Son. And the three things about how peace shall prevail here are that we see that there's a great and unending peace that's given. It's a great of the government of peace, that there will be no end, and also that there's a just and righteous kingdom reign of God, and that this Messiah, Jesus, will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. So this affirms Jesus' lordship right now.
Yeah.
And his reign right now as the Prince of Peace. And then the third thing here is that God will accomplish this transformative peace for us and within us. So, and then we see that in the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. So there is a work unfolding. It's like there's been a victory, and yet the, you know, we're in this saving work of God and in the peace that Jesus has given and keeps giving and shall complete, will accomplish.
The translation in this copy says, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Mm-hmm. In yours, what is the word that they use there? It's not increase.
Greatness.
Greatness. Okay.
The nexus of those two ideas. Israel got into making Israel great again instead of trusting in the work of God, right?
I'm not going there.
Yeah, it's okay. That's okay. That's okay. But it's a greatness of God's kingdom.
Yes.
Right. Go ahead to the increase.
Make Jesus great again. There we go. Yeah.
He already has been.
Yes. I think, however, there is a notion of governmentness which is more relevant to the way the word is applied here. Of the increase or of the greatness of his government, there will be no end. Now, what then, in the broadest, maybe most archetypal sense, what is a government? Government, then, is where, to my estimation, is where human beings organize and place authorities. That is, it is the body or the office that wields authority within a certain group. So rulership is maybe a broader term too, because you see it in Boy Scouts. Like when I was a Boy Scout as a child and a teenager, I was elected to various positions, patrol leader, senior patrol leader, things like that, and that is its own form of a government, because that's the big hoss who's gonna call the shots for that day. It's the nexus of organizational authority. So for the kingdom of God, the government is Jesus. That's it. it's just Jesus doing Jesus's thing in his myriad forms, whether he's the Holy Spirit, whether he's the Father, whether he's the body of Christ. Like it's
The body of Christ, too.
There's a concept, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. So government of the body and for the body.
Yeah. Yeah, it's but, this...
The... Yeah, but the point, of course, here is that God is the author, the one who pioneers through Christ this governance of the kingdom of God on earth.
Precisely. The greatness of his government, the full sentence here is, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end.
Right, right.
So he's the guy with the authority, and what he's here to do is bring peace.
Right. And how does that, and this tells us it's different from other governments, because every government has its day, but the kingdom of God has no end.
Yeah.
And that tells us something. We're living at a time when people are concerned about the transfer from one leadership to another in our country.
Yeah.
And that's always an issue around the world between, when one group of people has power, then another group of people then has their turn. But what we see here in the kingdom of God is that it transcends that, but it's different from what people define, and there's something that supersedes our temporal governments when it comes to the kingdom of God. And it reminds me of what Jesus said, you're looking here and there for the kingdom of God, but the kingdom of God, first and foremost, is within you, right?
Yeah.
And this is what you discovered when you came to faith.
Yeah, in a way, I became a Christian before I called it that, because my experience... I had a number of, not a large number, anything like two or maybe three tops, what I would call maybe mystical experiences. Uh-huh. And they were brought on through, one of them occurred when I was chanting to a Hindu goddess of love. Not romantic love, but like the sort of agape kind of love. It's the same concept. And I was chanting and really working with it, and I came into the presence of what I can only describe as the oneness of the love of God, and I was just completely crushed by it. And here, like, I was at work at a construction site. I had been chanting for an hour.
So, in spite of your imperfect chant,
and my imperfect heart and mind at the time, I was not a happy or well-adjusted human being.
In spite of that, God and Jesus show up
Yeah.
In marvelous love and light, and say, "Hey, buddy, we love you."
Yeah.
I'm using colloquial, but we love you, and here's the reality that you think it's this, but here we are.
It was one of the most impactful moments of my entire life, and I was the only person who was even close to aware that it was happening at that time. Sure. I'm just standing with tears just streaming down my face, and that was far, that was years before I began to talk to Jesus, years before I started to pray, years before I started to read the Bible. And that moment, nonetheless, I think it catalyzed me towards, like, okay, I now have proof God is super real. And it's not objective proof, it doesn't matter. It's just, I know this now. It's something that's in me, and that's led me the rest of the way back to God.
Yeah, and it reminds me of what Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." And so the Lord knew your heart. And in that moment, even though, you know, you weren't saying just the right words, you were saying something very different,
yeah,
he could see that your heart, that you wanted to know the truth. And God and Jesus revealed themselves to you in this love. And the good thing about the Lord and his peace is he keeps pursuing us.
Yeah.
Even when we may go astray, he will keep calling us and drawing us into his peace and the governance of his peace in us. Even when we may go astray or follow other things, the Lord keeps calling us. And to me, that's what Christmas is all about, is that incarnation, that revelation, that God coming to us and even, you know, to the broken world at the time that he came, and to the broken world that we live in, he keeps coming. I mean, even COVID is a reminder that, hey, come back to me. Know the true peace. In the other part of verse 7, we have, he will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. What about that, about the just and righteous kingdom reign of God?
I think that kind of goes back to the notion of the government being saddled on Christ's shoulders.
Hmm.
Because he's the only one who's capable of wielding that office correctly.
Yeah.
All of those things then are products of it. Yeah. Like, you know, it's a kingdom that is free of ego judgments, because, well, we know the guy that's the only one possibly capable of judging. We know peace, we know forgiveness. And I think my own life maybe has been, thus far, it's been an example of that, because I think grace is what that looks like in the moments, is what that looks like in practice.
Right.
Maybe. Is because, like you said, maybe I wasn't using the right words. I don't necessarily think there really are right words. Like,
right.
That's like, there are, right, there are no magic words to,
right,
get you into heaven. It's all, like, you, it's not the words themselves, it's the intent.
Right.
Do you want God? Do you want God's love? Are you open to that?
Uh-huh.
And I think if we're being fully humble, the way maybe that we're called to be, like, there are no right words, but we'll use whatever words are working at that moment. And the Holy Spirit, God, Jesus, pick one, all one, they will use whatever you're working with at that moment to bring you in, because the grace and the forgiveness are what they lead with. Thank God.
Amen.
Because yeah, that's what we need most. Like,
yeah, and that's that whole work of that kingdom that God is establishing. And if a person has that heart of openness and availability and desire, God sees that. I saw this really cool thing by Leonard Bernstein called The Mass. It shows this Catholic priest who keeps putting on robe after robe after robe that people keep layering on him. And as he's taking on the burdens of the people, and he's trying to assume a position as a priest and one who ministers grace, at a certain point it becomes too much.
Mm.
just too much. And that can happen when we try to take on too much.
Yeah.
And don't trust in that righteousness that God gives and how God helps us. And when we allow His justice and His righteousness to be that which, you know, cleanses us as well as adorns or clothes us in grace.
That's actually, I really like that notion of the priest having just, you know, endless robes put on him.
Right.
That's, I think perhaps we must go to God naked. Because all of these adornments, and not necessarily physical clothes, but the way that we approach ourselves, we try to clothe ourselves in these identities, these roles.
Right.
It's what people do when they try to get into positions of power.
Right.
And
right.
It's part of why it goes so wrong, because they forget their humanity.
Right.
They become so convinced, like, oh, I'm the guy with the big stick. That's
right.
Who I am. It's not, I'm a human being who is currently playing the role of a person with a big stick.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, I am that person. I am king.
Yeah.
You can't say I'm not. Look at the crown. Come here. Like, it's that kind of fierceness, because we want to identify with something so badly, but that is hubris. And what is required to break us from that, to allow us to really be forgiven, to be healed, to be compassionate, loving people, then once the healing and forgiveness have started to do their work, the way that we make the world a better place, to usher in this kingdom of God, the way we do that is that we have to take our clothes off before God can clothe us
right.
in what He seeks to dress us in. And that's a really interesting notion, is the priest being inundated by just all the fabric. I like that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And, yeah. And also that it's God who accomplishes this. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Let's talk about that transformative work of God's Spirit and His zeal for us.
The Spirit of God is indomitable. It is. It's about the only thing I can think of that never gives up. That's the one thing it doesn't have capacity for, is to give up.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
The most indomitable, the most enduring thing ever is this. Because we are running from it all the time. Oh, man. We are looking to get away from that as much as we can. At some point, I have been very low, and there meets me this love. That same love I met in the construction site where I was completely crushed. Like,
the Prince of Peace.
Precisely. Yeah.
Almighty yeah. God. Wonderful Counselor.
Yeah, Everlasting Father.
There you go. And that renewed encounter in whatever way, shape, or form it is, be it quiet and gentle or vibrant and bright, that ongoing zeal of God,
yeah.
That ongoing work of God's Spirit, that ongoing word from the Scripture, that ongoing prayer, And being aware of how God will bring people to help us even. There are times that God has an appointed revelation or intervention.
Talk about zeal.
Yeah, that's zeal right there.
Yeah.
Hey, this has been great. I look forward to more times that we can really get into the Word and probe its some of its depth, both personally and you know, in our life, as we live now in this 21st century. Here it is, 2020, and with COVID, it just seems like we are even more aware of the need for peace beyond just, you know, things being comfortable. That's not peace.
Yeah.
Right?
That actually, I guess, are you trying to wrap it up? Because we can get into closing thoughts.
Yeah.
So peace, I think, is when... Say it begins in a person. You have to start with yourself. You can't, you know, change the world, or even change your friend group if you can't do it yourself first. You got to work something out here, and that's where Christ comes in. I think first is you got to accept Him in here. It's that old chestnut. You got to let Him into your heart,
right?
And because if you read the Bible and you take the words that Jesus says seriously. And you take that and run with it, it will lead you, in a manner of speaking, to the felt presence. I think another conversation got into the eminence of God.
Yeah.
God is right here. He's right here all the time. It's the most real thing. It's the fun. It's that, if you want to break it down like phenomenologically, God is the most real thing. It's the bedrock of all reality, all realities. It's the origin and the thing that's there the most forever. Both directions in time, outside of time, all of it. It starts that bedrock, that fundamental thing that is godness. But you follow what Christ would have you do to respond to them. Mm-hmm. That's the beginning. It's one of the beginnings of it. The other is understanding when you need to change things about yourself and accepting certain things as, well, that is the cross I am meant to bear. Other things as, I have to get rid of that because it's how I'm falling short of the sight and will of God. And when you start piecing together all these small things, it will fix, maybe not even the right word, but it will alleviate stress, and it will alleviate this deep rip that I think is at the heart of a lot of people. And so peace, and then who is the Prince of Peace?
The author, the governor, the
wonderful counselor.
The counselor of peace, yeah.
That's the thing.
Yeah.
It's that godness.
Well, hey, we could talk about this for eternity. Amen?
Amen.
let's have a time to pray.
Please.
We thank you, God, for your love for us and for your kingdom that abides in our hearts as we believe and we receive your grace, as we let your governance work within us, as we follow the path, Lord Jesus, you have shown us, that you lead us in daily. Help us be not only those who believe, but those who live and do your will. May we follow you, Lord Jesus, as the Prince of Peace, and may it be that we will experience that increase of your peace as we follow you. And even though there are definite conflicts and things going on around us, we know ultimately that your peace prevails and will help us prevail over the impasse that we see all around us. Ultimately, your kingdom is eternal, everlasting, and there shall be the transformation of our hearts and minds and this world into thy kingdom.